about any subjects they wish to address. These items on the communications calendar must be scheduled in advance with the clerk's office. Second, people may sign up for public testimony on the first readings, reports, resolutions, and ordinances. If you sign up, your testimony must address the matter being considered at the time. Please state your name for the record. We don't need your address. If you're a lobbyist, please disclose that. And if you're here representing an organization, please identify the organization. Individuals have 3 minutes to testify unless otherwise stated. You have 30 seconds left. The yellow light's going to light up. And when your time is done, the red light will come on. Conduct that disrupts the meeting, for example, shouting or interrupting others' testimony or interrupting during council deliberations, is not allowed. People who disrupt the meeting face ejection from the meeting. If there's a disruption, I'll issue a warning that if any further disruption occurs, anyone who's disrupting the meeting will be subject to ejection for the remainder of the meeting. Anyone who fails to leave the meeting after being ejected will be subject to arrest or trespass. If you'd like to show your something, a simple thumbs up will do. If you want to express that you don't support something, thumbs down is good. Thanks, and started with council communications. Carla, please call the first item.
Item 455, a request of Standard Schaefer to address council regarding emergency medical services, fire, and Portland Police Bureau crowd control policy.
Good morning.
My name is Standard Schaefer, and I'm with Empower Portland. I'm not here to talk about EMTs today. I'm here to talk about recent police actions regarding protests. It's important for you guys to realize that trampling our rights has real live consequences. Current social science shows that riot cops showing up at crowd control escalates the situation. I realize that you guys think that you can just strong arm people into submission, but unfortunately you're radicalizing a lot of the population. If you want to know where the anarchists come from, next thing I need to say is that we've had several witnesses coming forward with statements about police entering the march at the start. I've seen video of police interfering with protest organizers. Organizers who told them, by the way, when we negotiated this permit, we didn't want cops in the middle of the march, and there they were. The police intimidation is pretty widespread at this point at protests. We have people being pulled over before the 82nd Avenue incident on Saturday, being told, being pulled over for petty violations, petty citations, and being told that they are attracting too much attention on their way to the protest. This interference with the right to assembly is a problem. We need to stop interfering with the infrastructure of the protests themselves. We have got cops intimidating street medics. Excuse me, Mr. Wheeler, are you listening?
I'm listening.
Thank you. Journalists are being intimidated. Mobility vehicles are being taken out of the margins. Endangering disabled people. Cop watchers are being harassed and detained. And legal observers, too. This last one particularly concerns me, because if it wasn't for legal observers outside the Portland building when I was arrested, well, for the incident in which I was accused of robbery, too, I would probably be in jail. So, people's lives are being affected by this stuff, and we need to respect the rights of the legal observers. We need to get real training around what's going on at crowd control, because the police don't seem to know the rules about cop watchers. They don't know the rules about filming the police, and they don't seem to respect legal observers. These are the people that are the last bastion of hope for us who are worried about police accountability, because the city has already given away its authority to rein in the police. We're told that phone calls make a difference, but we have police and police commissioners dissembling and not giving accurate information to the media. So when the media-induced phone calls come in, they're very exaggerated. We're not listening to the people on the ground who actually document and file reports. We're filing public reports every time there's public input available for community input on crowd control. We don't even know where it goes. We never hear back from it. It's time to reopen the crowd control policies and include these kinds of concerns, ones around protecting legal observers.
Thank you. Next item, please.
Item 456, request of Melanie Plock to address council regarding moving Portland to 100% clean energy and threats to the city from climate change.
Good morning.
Good morning, it's loud like sauerkraut. Mayor Wheeler, council, my name is Melanie Plock. I'm an OB/GYN physician. I retired last year and decided that climate change was my number one priority, and I've been a volunteer with 350 PDX. In the last few months, I've met with staff, all of your staff, to talk about the Cardy gas plants and the transition to renewables. You've probably heard this quote before, "The planet isn't dying, it's been killed by people, and those people have names and addresses." Today, I'm asking you to act bravely to be sure that those addresses don't belong to those of us who live here in Portland. On June 1st, the council will vote on the 100% by 2050 plan put forth by Mayor Wheeler. I urge you to keep this resolution strong. You may already be hearing from those in industry who say it isn't feasible for one reason or another. This simply isn't true. All it takes is the will to do it. In order to keep our beautiful planet livable, we need to enact a fossil fuel freeze as soon as possible and start an immediate transition to renewable energy. I'd like you to think about these dates for a minute. First of all, 2050. Knock wood, we will all live that long. And by then, we need to have decarbonized our electricity, transportation, and heating sectors in order to limit warming to 2 degrees. Next, 2100. It sounds like a long time away, but there were babies born yesterday who will likely see that date. I've delivered thousands of babies in my time. If we don't act bravely today, those babies might face a world that borders on the uninhabitable. These are not hypothetical people. They are here right now. With luck and hard work, we can bequeath these new Oregonians a world where global warming is actually being reversed, or as Paul Hawken calls it, a drawdown. To get there, a recent paper in the journal Science offers a handy rule of thumb we can use. It's sort of like Moore's Law about semiconductors. Here's the rule. We need to cut our CO2 emissions in half every decade. So, some more dates. Between 2020 and 2030, we have to cut emissions in half. Then half again between 30 and 40, etc. So, to bring this back to the June 1st resolution, I urge you to do three things. Number one, stick to the goal date of 2030 for the clean renewable electricity sector, not 2035. Other larger cities, such as San Diego, are doing it even sooner. Companies like Apple are moving faster. It isn't radical. We can do it. Electricity is about 30% of our carbon emissions, so we have to do this if we're going to meet that rule of thumb I talked about. Don't be seduced by dirty alternatives like nuclear, biomass, waste incineration, or any kind of fossil fuels. Keep a strict definition. This has to be a just transition. It's going to require big changes. Some of them are going to fall hardest on those who are already suffering the most. We can help with that if we partner with those communities. Finally, if you haven't already, please submit your comments to the PUC opposing PGE's plan to build new gas plants at Cardy before the day after tomorrow, Friday, and join us in testifying in front of the PUC next Monday. New fossil fuel infrastructure is completely incompatible with the transition to clean energy. We, the people of Portland, ask you to do what is right and make a rapid and just transition to 100% clean and renewable energy. We're counting on you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you, Commissioner. Next item, please.
Item 457, request of Joe Walsh to address council regarding communication.
Good morning.
Good morning. For the record, my name is Joe Walsh. I represent Individuals for Justice. I come not to praise you, I come to warn you. The third century part of the Roman Empire collapsed, and we are repeating the same disaster. What does this have to do with Portland? Everything. Mayor, you came here into office thinking that you are the person to tame the ongoing protests that was all taking place during the last, and also your administration. So I come to warn you, so you cannot say we did not know. Forget the fact that we have a Caligula in D.C. What you are doing with the Imperial Guard, or as we now call them, the police, is what we should look at. And you use the guard to punish the houseless. You use the guard to arrest those who dare to say no to your illegal orders. Often the DA and the courts have now thrown out the charges against those who you had arrested. You have met in private with those who would run this city as a city-state of Greece, or maybe in the Middle Ages in the House of Medes. Dictator by any other name is still a dictator. You care only for your own prosperity, and if that is in line with the people's needs, we will not suffer. But if there is a conflict, we will and are suffering. We ask you to resign your good offices for the sake of the city. All same commissioner, you daily have been given our petition under the state and federal constitution to resign your office. We will continue from time to time to update the signatures from your constituents as they grow in number. Your guard has now resorted to giving out jaywalking tickets to cop watchers and protesters. I would like to thank you for that action, because what you have done is you've taken people that just wanted justice and are making radicals out of them, and I thank you for that. More and more radicals means we may think about expanding the homeless. They're expanding the protest at your houses so your police can keep busy. We are in need of strong local government who will stand with us for sanctuaries and other things, and we do not have it now. Trumpy barbarians are at the gates. We ask you to go with our blessings, but go. And don't thank me.
Next item, please.
Item 458, request of Merrick Bonneau to address council regarding settlement agreement arrest record.
Good morning.
Andre Wheeler.
Good morning.
I'm sorry, could I ask you to state your name, sir? Correct.
Yeah, my name is Merrick Bonneau.
Thank you.
That's not an alias.
Thank you, sir.
On April 13th, 2016, I was profiled and targeted by plainclothes Homeland Security and DEA agents at Amtrak. My Fourth Amendment rights were violated by the use of a police dog. Under the Fourth Amendment, probable cause must be established and a signed search warrant by a judge must be acquired before conducting any search. The use of police dogs to smell passengers and their belongings constitutes a search and is therefore a violation of the Fourth Amendment. I was arrested for not consenting to a search and taken to the federal building. I was interrogated for over 6 hours and was released without being booked and without paperwork. On April 14th, 2016, I got a copy of my arrest record. The records were not updated to show the previous day's arrest, but I was made painfully aware that the police had manipulated my arrest record and put multiple false charges on my arrest record. Also, the city had not followed through with the expunging of my arrest record as per settlement agreement. The settlement agreement that the city council forced through despite my informing the council that I was under duress at the time, and I wish to have them set aside this settlement agreement. Because the city council forced through the settlement agreement, there is I have also not received a letter of regret from the city for my police brutality in 99 as per settlement agreement. The police manipulating my arrest record and putting false charges on my arrest record is a crime and constitutes police corruption. The city not following through with their settlement agreement constitutes negligence. On April 25th, 2016, I got another copy of my arrest record. My race had been changed from black to white, and the Amtrak arrest was labeled detained and released, not arrested. I believe this was done to cover up the illegality and severity of my arrest, as well as the unconstitutional use of police dogs to search Amtrak passengers. On April 13, 2003, my IAD complaint rose to City Council. During that hearing, Mayor Vera Katz read a false portion of deposition from one of my witnesses, Kay Huxford. I believe this was done in an effort to exonerate the police of wrongdoing and to make me look dishonest. Falsifying my witness depositions is a crime and constitutes City Council and City Attorney collusion and corruption. The constitutional rights of the people are the foundation that our country is built on and must be upheld no matter what the cost. If they are not, what is the use of having the Constitution? What is the point of swearing to uphold and defend the Constitution if the public officials you ignore the Constitution, or excuse me, if as public officials you ignore the Constitution? In efforts to protect yourself and your fellow public servants from liability, the constitutional rights of the people are more important than somebody's job. The Fourth Amendment is in place to keep us safe from unreasonable search and seizure by agents of the government. For the record, we are all innocent until proven guilty. That right should always be in place, otherwise we are no longer living in a free country with tyranny. There's the Fourth Amendment. The right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrants shall be issued but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describe the places to be searched and the persons and things to be seized. I was not done in my case and is a clear violation of the Fourth Amendment rights.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, you forgot. Yeah, there's an electronic device.
Sir.
Grab that device, please.
Yeah, we'll do it. It's like a nice one. You don't want to leave that one. Thank you. And I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with your case, but legal counsel is here, and I'll
I gave every single one of you council members a packet of information, which included all of this information, as well as the CD I had of me and Commissioner Salt, and we had some review together. So you guys
okay,
have all
I've got that. Great. Thank you. I appreciate that. Next item. I'm sorry, Barbara.
459, request of Robert McCullough to address council regarding Washington High School Southeast Community Center.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mayor. Good morning, Commissioners. It's a pleasure to see you today. Please do not quit. I believe I voted for each one of you, but I always agreed with each one of you. Mayor, sometimes the mayor provides another minute or so for a recognized organization like Southeast Dublin. As I listened to Dr. Paul, I hope I said that right, I was hoping you might grant me 1 minute to comment on our words. Thank you. Dr. Paul said, you'll be hearing from industry experts and representatives opposing the adoption of renewables. I am actually a bona fide expert on this issue. A report on that was provided throughout the region, published in I think 50 different papers and articles on the dramatic reduction in the cost of renewables. Over the last 5 years, the cost of renewables have gone down 50%. They're now cheaper than our nuclear plant. They're cheaper than large baseload units. There's nothing magic about it. This was simply technology. We've made enough of them. We've gotten good at it. They're cheap, they're safe, they're easy to install. And as Dr. Paul said, so much better than I did. We're going to be living here and our children will be. So please give her words all the attention you can. I think she's right.
Thank you, sir.
I'm now changing my hat to Southeast Uplift, and I'll be very brief.
Thank you.
Many years ago, Hugh Smith, senior partner over at Stoli Goli, brilliant, wonderful lobbyist, mainly on the federal side, said, if you keep talking long enough, people will give in just to stop having to listen. As you know, we've been working on the Washington High School Southeast Community Center for many, many years. And we have absolutely nagged you to death. I apologize for this. But it's an important issue. Council clerk, would you put up my one slide? So this is the community center we don't have. And I put it up simply to shame you a little bit. All of you have endorsed the concept at one point or another. I was not in any meetings with Commissioner Daly on it, but I presume this is the sort of thing you'd like to see for our city. Where I am on this is our last chance to talk to you before the time runs out on our first right of refusal on 1.3 acres we would like to keep open. Earlier last week, I was in a boardroom high above Vancouver, British Columbia, with Shell executives and the head of an Indian group. Robert Dennis, the secretary of the Hawaiian tribe, looked at the executives and said, "I don't like excuses." I thought actually about asking him to fly down and give the speech for me. We have a lot of excuses why we haven't moved forward. They're good excuses. Mayor, you explained you didn't have $10 million. I know that. I sit on the appropriate committee. But we've also been told lawsuits. We have answers to the lawsuits. Contract issues. We don't have to pay all the money up front. There are solutions to this. So one last time, I would beg you, consider calling the school district and saying, we have 200,000 neighbors who want to save this land. Will you negotiate with us? We have solutions. We have money, actually. And what we need is a chance. Now, I don't expect to win this argument, and I will respect you no less if I lose. But I do warn you that I'm very boring, and you have to put up with me for years to come, because we need this place for our kids, for our older folks, for our families, and we don't have it. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, sir. Why don't we go to the consent agenda, if there have been any items pulled off the consent agenda.
Yeah, item 464 is being pulled.
Yeah, 464 is actually being returned to the mayor's office, so please call the roll on the remainder.
Fish.
Aye.
Saltzman.
Aye.
Fritz.
Aye.
Aye. The consent agenda is adopted. First time certified.
Item 460, accept the street tree inventory report.
Commissioner Fritz.
Thank you, Matt. Really happy to introduce this item. Spectacular collaboration between the Department of Recreation, Urban Forestry Division, and volunteers all over the city. Open Parks and Recreation, Urban Forestry Department has completed one of the largest inventory of street trees, city trees in the United States, Sky Management of Portland's Urban Forest. Street trees are a crucial public asset that provide health and economic benefits to our community. And today we'll hear about the inventory findings of the Urban Forestry staff and the Urban Forestry Commission's Policy Committee. Mm-hmm. So, delighted to introduce Jen Cairo, the City Forester.
Thank you, Commissioner Fritz. Good morning, Mayor and Commissioners. For the record, I'm Jen Cairo, City Forester and Manager of Urban Forestry, which is a division of Parks and Recreation. And with me today for this presentation are Angie DeSalvo, Urban Forestry Outreach and Science Supervisor and founder and manager of the Volunteer Street Tree Inventory. Also, not enough chairs, but Mark Bellow is somewhere here. He is the chair of the Urban Forestry Commission and also served on the Title 11 Implementation Oversight Advisory Committee. Jim Labby will be presenting. He is a 2016 recipient of the Bill Nato Community Trees Award. He's also been on the Title 11 Implementation Advisory Oversight Committee and is currently working with the Policy Committee of the Urban Forestry Commission. And lastly, Dr. Vivek Shandas, Director of the Sustaining Urban Places Research Lab at Portland State University, and also a member of the Urban Forestry Commission. Our presentation today has two parts. Angie and I will fill you in on the street tree inventory and put it within a context, especially for Mayor Wheeler and Commissioner Udaly before whom we have not spoken before. And the second part will be our commission partners speaking to the future of street trees in the city. Please ask any questions whenever you will. Urban Forestry's mission statement is to preserve and ensure the urban forest and the services it provides for current and future generations of Portland residents. Our work includes the physical full life cycle tree work of tree planting, young and mature tree care, tree removal when necessary, and planting again in various ways. We also respond to tree hazards and emergencies in city rights of way and city properties 24/7 in all weather. We monitor and assess the forest and forest services, develop and implement tree policies and programs such as the city's urban forest management plan. We implement city tree regulations through outreach, permitting, and enforcement. And we also foster local community tree knowledge and stewardship. Finally, we work with residents and partners collaboratively to support Portland's trees, including the Urban Forestry Commission, which is 11 residents who volunteer their time and energy to support and advise decision makers on all things trees in the city. In arboriculture, we have a saying, trees are the answer. And for many things important to everyone, not just urban foresters, that statement is absolutely true. Research has repeatedly shown that trees are needed in cities for many reasons, and I'm going to just focus on two right now for the sake of time. The first of those is that they improve public health in important ways, including providing cleaner air, taking up carbon dioxide and particulates from the air, and off-gassing essential oxygen. They reduce levels of heat-related illness and human mortality from heat. They increase babies' birth weights and reduce the amount of time people spend recovering from illness in hospitals or being out of work. The second service of trees that's essential in cities that I'll stress today is that they are a key climate resilience tool for urban areas. They reduce summer heat in homes and in streets, and the loss of trees correlates closely with higher temperatures in summer and urban heat island effect. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration promotes urban forests as green infrastructure to fight the effects of climate change. Chicago speaks of, quote, fortifying the urban forest as a strategy to counter climate change. And of course, trees play a prominent role in Portland's own climate action plan. I want to note that these issues often disproportionately affect people of color, less affluent, and underserved communities in cities, including Portland. These residents increasingly need these and other tree services. Our urban forest is essential infrastructure, no less important than the streets, power lines, water pipes, sewer systems, bridges, and the like. Or another way to look at it is, what would Portland be without its trees? So Angie will now speak to one component of the city's urban forest, street trees.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. My name is Angie DeSalvo. I'm with Urban Forestry, and I'm so pleased to be here today to bring you the results from our street tree inventory completed last year. Just to clarify, today I'm talking about trees in the public right-of-way. Our urban forest has many components, our private trees, our park trees, but here we're talking about right-of-way trees. Those trees that line our streets, the first to greet you when you walk out your home. They buffer our transportation corridors, and they're also the primary way that our residents in the city interact with nature. And we went about inventorying these trees with a large group of volunteers. And I want to first emphasize that the maintenance of these trees is done by the adjacent property owner. So keep that in mind as we go forward with this. In Portland, we have a long history of urban forest management, and our very first inventory was conducted in 1938 by the Works Progress Administration, and then again in 1976 by the Parks Department, and most recently, we completed our largest effort to date last year, and the city has grown quite a bit since those first two inventories. And we need reliable data about what's happening with our street trees so that we can adequately manage and maintain that very important resource. And so this data is driving our management. I mentioned that street trees are maintained by adjacent property owners. So in Portland, of course, we have to involve our residents in collecting this data. So we could have gone out and just collected the information, but instead we opted to partner with our communities. And so we set about neighborhood by neighborhood, talking to people, asking them to come with us on this journey to learn their trees, help us to map and measure, collect data and do this together. And over 6 years, we collected information on 220,000 street trees in all 95 neighborhoods. 1,300 people assisted us, and most of these had never volunteered with parks before. This was their first opportunity and interaction to work with urban forestry or the city. And together, they gave 17,000 hours. And that's the equivalent of one person out there walking the street every day for about 8.5 years. So we're incredibly proud of the community coming together to assist us with this project. Now, anytime you use volunteers, when you are collecting data, you have to design your project carefully. And we made sure to collect enough information, but to allow it to be accurate enough so that we could teach people to ID and collect information. And so we collect information on what type of trees, the species, their size or diameter at breast height. Here you see two folks out measuring the size of this nice street tree. We gave them a condition rating, good, fair, poor, or dead. We mapped their location, and we also collected information on the site. Now, we had an excellent accuracy rate, 95%. We were just cited in urban forestry and urban greening as one of the highest for volunteer inventories, and I really give a lot of credit to our professional arborist community. At the hundreds of work days that we held, we had two volunteer arborists, usually on bikes, writing about making sure that our volunteers were collecting accurate information. And so without their assistance, I'm sure our accuracy rate would have dropped. But together as a team, we collected great information.
Can I interrupt for a second? Because when I saw that image when I was reviewing this, I said, oh, so then you have to, they're measuring the circumference, so then you have to go home and do the whole 2πr or whatever it is. And in fact, the wonders of modern science, they have double-sided tape measures, one of which is the actual inches and the other converts it to diameter by doing the circumference, which is a nice thing.
Yep. Two measurements, one tape.
You got it.
And I will stress that the way that we designed this project, we had two goals. One was to go out and collect great information to get this data, but the second was to create an education project, to outreach, and to really work with people to get out in their communities. Both of those goals are mandated to us through our urban forest management plan. So we accomplished both. This is a map of where we worked. Each of those green dots is a tree. You will notice that we have more trees towards the center of the city. On the west side, you see a bit fewer, but that's because this particular protocol is not geared towards natural wooded areas. And so most of our street trees are located in that central area of the city. And as you move east, you see that they become fewer and farther apart. Some highlights from our key findings. Looking at that map, you'll see that our trees are not equitably distributed. I'm going to talk more about that in just a moment, but they're not located evenly throughout the city. However, we have abundant opportunities for planting. Over 90,000 sites are open and available, ready for trees right now. We're overly reliant on just a handful of tree types. Maples, Acer, 27% of our street trees are maples. Plums and cherries in the Prunus genus are also highly overrepresented. This leaves few very large, native, and evergreen trees. Those trees that are very important for providing services, those are few and far between. And many of our trees are young. We've had some very successful planting efforts, but they are not necessarily